brother?
I will not lose you again, Deimos. Come! The fight is not over!
After the Great War with the Titans, the Oracle had foretold the demise of the Olympian gods and the destruction of Olympus. She saw that it would be brought about not by the hands of the Titans, who thirsted for revenge, but by the hands of a mortal, a marked war.
The Ghost of Sparta.
Kratos inspired fierce loyalty in his men. It had always been enough to carry them through any battle. Until this day, the soldiers faced a massacre, while their young captain faced the end of his brilliant career. But to Kratos, victory was worth any price, even his soul.
Ares, destroy my enemies, and my life is yours!
To make you beholden only to him, Ares devised three blood tasks. Spill the blood of your enemies. The blood of the innocent. The blood of your enemy.
You will become death itself.
His skin white with the ash of his dead family. The ghost of Sparta had been born.
The slayer of Ares.
Athena!
We request one final task of you, Kratos. Athens is on the verge of destruction. Zeus has forbidden the gods from waging war on each other. Only a mortal trained by a god has a chance at defeating Ares.
Then the visions, they will end?
And the past that consumes you will be forgiven.
You are the first mortal to ever reach Pandora's box. You must bring the box back to my city and use it to kill Ares.
You will rot in the depths of Hades for all eternity.
Athens needs you.
But how did you know I was?
Athena isn't the only god keeping watch on you, Spartan.
Zeus! Do you see now what your son can do? Even Pandora's box is mine!
The monster you've created has returned to kill you.
The gods of Olympus have abandoned me. Now there is no hope.
And now, the destroyer of Atlantis.
Kratos. Help me.
It was a dream, nothing more.
The visions still haunt me, Athena. The visions you promised to take away.
Your brother does not have much time. He lives, trapped in torment, deep in death's domain. Finally, I am free.
Mother, the marked warrior, shall bring about the destruction of Olympus, the beginning of the end.
Your father forbid me to tell
you. My father? Who is my father?
Now, only one.
By defeating Ares, Kratos, the once mortal warrior, became the new god of war. However, Kratos soon found himself alone on Olympus, shunned by his fellow gods. But Kratos had no need for the love of petty gods. He had found a new family in the warriors of Sparta, gaining solace from his past and calling to battle.
My lord, Kratos! Another city is ready to fall! Soon all shall know the glory of Sparta!
Enough, Kratos! With every city you destroy, the wrath of Olympus grows. Soon I will no longer be able to protect you.
I need no protection.
Do not forget that it was I who made you a god, Ghost of Sparta. Do not turn your back on me.
I owe you nothing.
Then you leave me no choice.
Kratos had turned the pain of his memories into hatred. Hatred for the gods, who had refused to free him from the nightmares of his past deeds. And so he went to Rhodes to deliver the final blow to the besieged city.
I've been waiting a while to say this. Welcome, everybody, to Let's Play God of War 2, the direct sequel to Santa Monica Studios' 2005 classic, God of War. God of War 2, for some basic information, as we always do in the beginning, came out in 2007. Made in the same Kinetica engine as the original God of War 2 is the highly praised, highly beloved sequel to the original God of War. This time, the game was directed by Corey Barlog, with some assistance from David Jaffe as well, who was the director of the original God of War. Corey Barlog, of course, directed this game. He was a lead animator for the original God of War, a story writer for Chains of Olympus, helped with story layout for the upcoming God of War 3 title that we're going to let's play, was a writer for Ghost of Sparta, and of course, he famously directed a little-known God of War spin-off called God of War for the PlayStation 4. So, big deal. So, the guy working on this, it's fantastic. Brief cutscene.
By the gods, he's killed them all! He still has some of the powers of a god! Run!
This game is awesome. There's no other way to put it. As the direct follow-up to the original God of War 2 had the expectation of a sequel to deliver everything the original did, but do it better and add more stuff that people would like and get rid of some stuff that people didn't like as much. And God of War 2 basically did that. It is a beloved title. It is one of the best sequels that exist in the medium of video games. Many people agree that it's far better than the original God of War. I'm one of those people. We're going to discuss all the reasons why as we get further into this let's play. But God of War 2 is amazing, and it's amazing right from the get-go. This opening sequence in Rhodes is, I would put it on par with the opening sequence in the Aegean Sea in the original God of War. I don't necessarily know if one is better than the other. They're both amazing opening sequences for very different reasons. The original God of War opening sequence in the Aegean Sea, you know, was basically the perfect tutorial that taught you everything you need to know about the upcoming game. This also is the perfect tutorial that teaches you everything you know about the upcoming game, but it has the added benefit of of providing the power fantasy and living up to the narrative that's established in the beginning. Kratos doesn't start off with the minimum amount of health and no magic as he would in every other God of War game we've played thus far. Instead, he starts off with maxed out stuff to enjoy the the power fantasy of being the new God of War. And there was a little surprise moment where the Colossus is here and we get to fight it already. Similar to the Hydra, the Colossus is our opening boss. We're going to fight it multiple times. Unlike the Scylla from Ghost of Sparta, which was the last game that we let's played, the Colossus is a phenomenal opening act monster for Kratos to fight. Similar to the Hydra, you have multiple battles with it. Every battle is a little bit different and a little bit different and introduces new things for you. And in this case, we have a basic battle with the Cyclops, with the Colossus, where it's going to throw hordes of basic enemies at you, which means that the Colossus itself isn't going to be doing that many attacks. And it's going to, you know, very clearly telegraph everything that it's doing to give you opportunity to get used to dealing with larger-than-life bosses. God of War 2 addresses one of the big complaints of the original God of War, that being that the original God of War didn't have enough bosses. It only had three. It had the Hydra, it had Pandora's Guardian, and then it had Ares at the very end. God of War 2 kicks things up a notch by having a whole plethora of bosses that we're going to be encountering throughout our whole adventure here. Phenomenal, and the Colossus is a fantastic opening act monster. Again, I've said it already, but it remains true that it is a phenomenal opening act monster. We're going to have our first QTE, and I'm going to do something very foolish. I'm actually going to mess up the first QTE. All of the first QTEs in the God of War Greek Saga are always the same button that you just press multiple times, and I still screwed this one up. I'm not proud that I screwed it up, but it is pretty cool because we get to see some of the failure animations for not doing the QTEs correctly. Yeah, that wasn't great that I messed up a basic square QTE. It is cool, though, because we get to see some of the unique animations the Colossus has. Santa Monica Studio put a lot of work into making this thing awesome, and that goes into, you know, part of that is making it look awesome even when you're messing up, but it's a really well-realized creature. There isn't much more to say. It's just a phenomenal, badass way to open the game. We're going to have a brief cutscene where we move to a new area. Ooh, I have been stuttering quite a bit. You can tell that I haven't done commentary in a little while. God of War 2 got delayed a little bit because I was also recording God of War 3 at the same time. But now that both games have both been recorded, hopefully it won't take as long to put God of War 3 together. But we'll see. It might still take some time. Here I'm just showing off the main menu options, you know, basic accessibility things that you would expect from a mid-2000s PS2 title. Nothing extravagant, but there's some stuff there that you can play with if you want. Right now we're in this bathhouse and we're about to encounter our next sexy time minigame. So here's a brief cutscene about the minigame.
Hi there.
All right, this channel isn't monetized, obviously, so that's why you can see all this. This is the most pointless of the sexy time minigames. Usually in God of War games, no matter what, sexy time minigames have at least some purpose in that they teach you the QTEs, which this one does do, but they also provide you with red orbs. This one is pointless in regards to the red orbs, at least in a basic playthrough. Now you may be wondering why that is, considering we just got a whole bunch of red orbs there. By the way, if you play the minigame again, you're not going to get anything, so the minigame's only worth playing one time. I just got a whole bunch of red orbs, so why am I calling it pointless? God of War 2, unlike the original God of War, or unlike Chains of Olympus and Ghost of Sparta, or unlike Ascension even, does its opening act a little bit differently. In that, ooh, excuse me a second, I need to take a sip of water. In It does its opening act a little bit differently in that Kratos has all of this power. By the way, we're seeing a save screen. We're seeing a save in the game here. It's the only time you'll see it until the very end of the game. As always, you know the drill. God of War 2 gives you the power fantasy of making you as powerful as you can for the beginning of the game, while not spoiling all the new things that you'll be getting throughout the course of your adventure. Because of the fact that you're as powerful as you can be right from the get-go, inevitably we're going to lose that power. And I'm sorry if that's a minor spoiler alert. The game came out in 2007. What can I tell you? You're going to lose your power by the end of this whole opening act here that we're in the middle of right now. So we're going to lose all of our power. That includes not just our health, not just our magic, not just the upgrades to our basic blades of Athena that we're carrying on our back. We're also going to lose all of our red orbs that we get in this area. So there are red orb chests, you do get red orbs from killing enemies, and you do get the red orbs from the Sexy Time minigame, but by the end of this opening hour, you're going to lose all of those red orbs, and you're going to lose them just before the first opportunity to actually use them to purchase upgrades. So the developers knew what they were doing there. They wanted to make sure that when it was time for you to actually start upgrading things, you started off purely at zero. In that you just had this first hour to enjoy the power fantasy a little bit before you properly started things off. Here's the Colossus again, just a simple mashing circle QT. So the developers knew full well what they were doing with this. And as to which approach do I like more, the ones from the other God of War games where we start at zero and we use this opening hour to start leveling ourselves up, or the God of War 2 and, spoiler alert, God of War 3 approach where we start off with a bunch of stuff and then lose it all at the beginning of the hour, and then after that hour we start off at zero. I don't know which one I like more and which one I like less. I think they both work really well, especially in God of War 2. This whole starting off fully powerful is really, really effective for the opening hour of God of War 2, and I would argue it's also really, really effective for the opening hour of God of War 3. So I like both approaches, where you start up, where you either start off with nothing and you work your way up in the opening hour, or you start off with everything in the opening hour, then you lose everything, and then you have to start working your way back up. I like it both ways. They're fine. Here we have the Colossus, again, growing at us Godzilla style. This is our second encounter with the Colossus. It's also going to be the first time that I'm going to die. I think two times, or one or two times, right? No, two times, yeah. Definitely two times. Jesus, that thing just backhanded me. The first two deaths of the playthrough. Hooray! We got them out of the way in the opening. Sometimes openings are easy enough that that's not going to happen, but in the case of Titan mode, and this is Titan mode, the highest difficulty level in God of War 2, we'll see that in a future episode. The Titan is really powerful. The Colossus is really powerful. The Titan's really powerful. The Colossus is really powerful. For the second battle with the Colossus, you have to recognize which attacks you need invincibility frames for and which attacks you can actually securely dodge out of the way of. The only attack you can securely dodge out of the way of is both that slam attack, because you can just swing out of the way. And there is also one attack where he brings this attack right here, where he brings his one arm down towards the end of the platform. That attack and the attack where he slams down are the only two attacks where you can safely dodge out of the way of them. Everything else he does is way too quick, covers way too much area, and does way too much damage. So for attacks where he's like backhanding you or like slamming the arena real quick with his arm or something, you want to use Poseidon's Rage, the magic from God of War 1, fully upgraded for this opening hour of God of War 2. You want to use Poseidon's Rage and its invincibility frames to both do damage on the Colossus and also to not take any damage. So any attacks where it's not going to slam its arm down at you, this attack is fine to dodge. But let's see another attack now. Actually, no, he's actually going to keep doing the basic slam attack. That's nice. That's nice of him to do that. This attack is also safe to dodge because you can just use the grapple point to go to the other platform if you want. But anything else aside from the two attacks you're seeing the Colossus do right now, those attacks are not safe for dodging. You have to use Poseidon's Rage to become invincible and to lay in some damage to the Colossus while you still can. Doesn't have that much health. It does a lot of damage, but it doesn't have that much health. So even in Titan mode, it's not going to take that long for you to bring this thing down to a QTE kill range. And in fact, we're done. It's down. It's ready to go for the second part of the QTE, wherein we will end this part of the fight. It's very difficult. Again, it's difficult to get used to because it's going to kill you so quickly with some of its undodgeable attacks. But once you recognize which attacks are dodgeable and which attacks have to, you know, you have to use invincibility frames for, the second Colossus fight is not that bad. Here we're introduced to the last kind of QTE. Pressing L1 and R1 really, really fast. And now we're going to have another cutscene where we transition into the Rhodes Palace, so I'll see you after that. Again, this is a really, really excellent opening that I really adore a lot and like playing a lot just on its own. It's really, really good. I actually have a story about that. When we eventually get to God of War 3, I'm going to tell you a little story about the recording process for God of War 3 and just how many times I had to play the opening hour of that game. Thank goodness the opening hour of that game is fun, because otherwise I would not have had a very good time with what happened with my recording of God of War 3. Here I'm just going through the other menus that we have access to. I believe this is the first God of War game. This stuff is all, you know, old hat. We've seen this before in the other titles. All of our attacks, the things that we can collect, you know, all that good stuff. This is the first game that's going to have a status screen. And we'll see the status screen in a little bit here. The status screen provides useful information, like how many times did I die, or how long have I been playing the game for. Very useful stuff to have. Here's the status screen right now. We also have all of the urns of power. We'll talk about the urns of power as they become relevant. For now, though, the game has slowed down a bit, and we have a chance to catch our breath in the Rhodes Palace. So now that we're in the palace and we're facing some basic archers and we have another save point, we can shift conversation a little bit to Cory Barlog, actually. Briefly a little bit about Cory Barlog. I found an interesting article about his development of God of War 2, of 2007's God of War 2. Turns out Cory Barlog, very humble, very kind person, was not confident making God of War 2. As he said in a tweet once, I had absolutely no idea what the hell I was doing pretty much the entire time, which, quite a statement when you're responsible for one of what is considered one of the best games on the PlayStation 2 and one of the best games of that particular generation. Every day it felt like I was thrown on a stage opening night to perform a musical that I'd never heard of, much less rehearsed. But I was inspired at every turn by a brilliant team, so that's nice to hear. Really, 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 really sweet to hear him compliment his team like that and acknowledge the difficult process that is game development. Obviously, God of War 2 turned out fantastic. So. I mean, what more is there to say, really? The game turned out phenomenal. We're about to collect a collectible. We're about to collect a collectible, if you can believe it. That's what collectibles are for, collecting. We have the Urn of Gaia, activate during bonus play. Bonus play is something that we will cover in the extras video, but essentially it is what God of War 2 calls its New Game Plus mode. New Game Plus mode is something, again, we're going to cover in the extras video. I kind of wish they called it New Game Plus mode instead of bonus play, but whatever. That's the smallest of all gripes that I could possibly have with this title. Calling one thing a different thing. There are a total of 6 urns of power in God of War 2. However, you can only actually collect 4 of them during as you play the story. The other 2 can only be collected through Challenge of the Titans, which is this game's version of Challenge of the Gods or the Challenge of Hades, things that we always cover in extras videos, so in the extras video, you'll see me do the Challenge of the Titans, and I'll also talk about what it takes to actually unlock the 2 urns of power that we cannot get through normal play. But thankfully, 4 of the 6 we're going to be getting as we play the game, right now. And they will also be covered in the collectibles guide, how to get those particular, how to get those four particular urns of power, as it were. So here we go, we're about done with the Rhodes Palace now, and it's time to kick things back up a notch after a nice smooth elevator ride. You'd normally expect elevator rides to be filled with monsters or some sort of timed death traps, but in this case, in the opening hour of the game, thankfully, it's just a nice camera angle, showing off that we're going to have nice camera angles just like in the original God of War. Very nice. The monster returns for another surprise scare, but this time we can just attack its eye and get it to back off. We don't need to destroy any of that stuff because he destroys it all for us and we get all the collectibles anyway.
Kratos.
I do not need your help, Zeus! I can take down this beast!
I offer you more than help, Kratos. I offer you power. I offer you the Blade of Olympus. It was this blade that ended the Great War and defeated the Titans. Drain your godly powers into the sword, Kratos. Only then will you reach your full potential.
Why do you aid me now?
What I do now, I do for the good of all Olympus.
All right, we have our new voice actor for Zeus. We have a new voice actor for, I think, most of the characters. I think Athena is voiced by the same person as she was in the original God of War, but I'm not completely sure. Zeus definitely is a different person. He's a different voice actor. You may recall how he sounded in the original God of War, and in God of War 2, he is a completely different person. And in fact, I actually want to look up who voices Zeus, if I can. Let's see. He was voiced by Paul Eading in the original God of War and Corey Burton in God of War 2 and God of War 3. Corey Burton, great job. I really like this voice of Zeus a lot. It's a great performance. And now that I'm actually here, let's actually look up Athena really quick because I don't remember if Athena is voiced by the same person or not. Let's see. Oh no, yes. Carol Rugger voiced her in God of War, God of War 2. Alright, cool. Very nice. She sounded similar, just considering that Zeus was so radically different, I thought maybe they switched a whole bunch of people up for God of War 2, but no, it was the Zeus actor, which is good. Nice. I also want to look up our Intrabit narrator's voice because the narrator is about to become a very big player in this whole franchise. I already spoiled who she was in the Ghost of Sparta Let's Play, but let's see. Linda Hunt voices our Intrabit narrator, with the exception of in God of War 3, where she's voiced by Susan Blakeslee. Nice. Wonderful performances all around by everyone. Kratos' voice actor, Zeus' voice actor, it's all really good performances. This game really, really does up the elements of what is needed for good Greek myths up a notch compared to the original God of War. The original God of War was great too, but this really kicks it up a notch and adds a whole bunch of personal stakes that are going to affect the player too. Because in God of War 1, you know, there was a whole tragic backstory, but it's, you know, the classic tragic backstory that you actually see through Kratos' eyes as he goes through his adventure in Pandora's temple, especially. But in this game, we're actually going to be, you know, firsthand witnesses and actual participants to the tragedy and, you know, betrayal and bad stuff that's going to happen to Kratos. And so we ourselves are motivated to get our vengeance, and it's really fantastic how they put this, how they sync up what Kratos is feeling and what a player is likely to be feeling through the act of gameplay. It's really good. It's one of the reasons why this opening act is really, really special. Again, in terms of is it better or worse than the original God of War's opening act, I would say they're about on par. But this one does do some special things, especially towards the end when we're going to find ourselves in a situation that we can really relate to, because it's going to be all done through gameplay, which is really cool. So the monster surprises us one more time, and we have our final encounter with the Colossus. As I was saying before I was interrupted, we have our final encounter with the Colossus of Rhodes. Do not get close to the Blade of Olympus, because he's just going to slam down really fast towards the Blade of Olympus, and you're not going to be able to dodge it, and you're going to take damage. And it's a lot of damage, because it's Titan mode, the highest difficulty in God of War 2, and you're probably going to die as I did. So the proper way you want to do this fight is stay away from the Blade of Olympus. Don't go near it, not yet, not while the Colossus is actively trying to attack you. Instead, you want to get close to the Colossus, do some basic attacks. Anytime it does anything, whether it tries to backhand you or slam down on the ground, just use your Rage of Poseidon to gain invincibility frames and do more damage to the Colossus that way. You'll eventually stun it. Once it's stunned, you can go to the Blade of Olympus and start draining your godly power into the blade itself. Here we go.
With your godly power drained into the blade, it will have the strength to destroy all who defy the gods.
Nice. So for part two of the fight, same thing. You still need to get close. You've lost all your red orbs. As I was saying, this whole opening act, you lose all of your power. This is where it happens. You haven't had a chance to upgrade anything yet, but now you can't, because you lost all your red orbs. So same strategy, get close to the Colossus. Attack it anytime it tries to backhand you or do any kind of slam or grinding on ground or a shockwave attack. Just keep using your Poseidon's Rage for invincibility frames. Now that you've lost your Poseidon's Rage, you can take advantage of the hand to immediately stun the Colossus. Don't use that hand until the very last part of the fight. Once you've stunned the Colossus two times and drained two parts of your godly power into the blade, When it's time to set up to do it a third time, that's when you want to drain your godly. That's when you want to take advantage of the hand of Colossus to slam it into him, because that is an immediate stun on the Colossus. So don't actually use that hand until the very end, because otherwise you'll be in a situation where you have no magic and you'll still have to be responsible for stunning the Colossus. And in higher difficulties, that's really difficult to do. After you get the Blade of Olympus, you're in phase two of the fight. Phase two of the fight is very simple. The Colossus only has one attack. It's going to use its damaged arm to spew blue fire at you. Just roll out of the way of that. It doesn't even do that much damage anymore because you have low health now, so the game is accounting for that. Just keep attacking with the Blade of Olympus. It's very powerful. It has a powerful L1 triangle attack that I do, which is when Kratos shoots the laser beam out of the blade, a la Legend of Zelda sometimes. And before you know it, you'll be at the Circle QTE and you'll be done with the fight. We're technically still fighting the Colossus, but the actual fighting of the Colossus is done now. And now we move on to the final part of the opening act, which is climbing the inside of the Colossus, which is really, really cool. It's a really, really nice... really nice idea that's really well executed here. As you can see, we've gone back into our power-up menu. We have lost our powered-up Blades of Athena. We no longer have Poseidon's Rage, obviously, and we are now stuck with the Blade of Olympus. It's very powerful, but you can't actually do much with it. You can't power it up. You only have a few attacks. They're very powerful attacks, obviously, but they're just a few attacks. And if you have gotten used to how Athena's Blades feel thus far leading up to this point, you might be a little bit thrown off at how the Blade of Olympus handles. You'll notice there that I got red orbs and that my orb counter didn't go up. That is proof that I am playing on Titan mode. Titan mode cuts the number of red orbs you get from anything, enemies, destructible objects, chests, in half. So anytime I destroy an object... As I was saying before, I was interrupted by the cutscene. Anytime you destroy an object that gives you red orbs that are only worth like one red orb each, the game is going to divide that into being into that red orb being worth zero. So if you see me collect red orbs and the red orb counter doesn't go up at all, it's because I'm collecting red orbs that are worth one red orb, and the game is just saying that, it's just dividing that by zero and saying that you get zero red orbs for that. So it's pretty difficult, pretty brutal. Because of this, this is going to be a God of War playthrough where I'm not going to be able to level up everything by the end of the story. I am going to be prioritizing the important things to level up, though, and we'll be seeing those as we play through the game. For now, however, we are at the end of our opening act, and again, we have this phenomenal situation where we get to climb the inside of the Colossus. God of War 2 is really good about diversifying its environments. God of War 1 had a problem where a lot of the game was just, it just looked the same. And it looked good, but it looked the same. Especially once you got to the Desert of Lost Souls and Pandora's Temple, the game became the same to look at for a really, really long time. For many, many hours, in fact, the game became the same to look at. God of War 2, however, tackles that problem with gusto, similar to the problem of only having three bosses in the original God of War. God of War 2 tackles these issues with great gusto and keeps diversifying and changing up the environment. Just when you think you're starting to get bored of looking at the place you're looking at, God of War 2 is going to change it up on you and really introduce something new and cool, like climbing the Colossus. This is a really, really impressive technical achievement for 2007 PS2. One of the reasons why this game is considered one of the greatest games, if not the greatest game, of the PlayStation 2 generation. I really, really like it. It's a lot of fun. Here we have our very first hidden chest, our very first true collectible. We got the urn of power earlier, but those are things for New Game Plus. This was our first true collectible, actually, the things that we're going to be collecting and using in the playthrough, that being a Gorgon's Eye. Similar to God of War 1, Gorgon's Eyes and Phoenix Feathers are back, and just like in God of War 1, you need 6 of each to level up your health or your magic. 6 eyes for more health, 6 Phoenix Feathers for more magic. There are a total of 18 eyes and 18 feathers. 4 urns, and 3 special chests that we'll get into much later, because they don't become relevant until much later, those special chests. This is an awesome camera angle, this whole, what's happening now, this is a freaking awesome shot there. I never ended up using it for any of the openings for this game, but I really should have, because that's a really good shot. But whatever, maybe for a God of War, maybe in a recap in God of War 3, I might end up using it. We'll see. For this section confuses a lot of people when they first play it. Lower the pendulum here, then attack it. Then as you're attacking it and as it's swinging back and forth, immediately climb back up and use the lever again to raise the pendulum up to the Colossus's eye level. At that point, you'll be able to actually start navigating this rope here, now that the eyes are going to be blocked briefly by the pendulum every now and again. There we go. And that is the end of our first puzzle, and this is going to be the end of the inside of the Colossus. A really, really, really cool segment. We're about to finally destroy this thing in a really impressive manner that none of the other monsters got destroyed. And I think even the things from the later games, that being 3, Ghost of Sparta, especially Ghost of Sparta, and Ascension, don't get taken out in as impressive a manner as the Colossus, I think. The Colossus is a really, really cool, really, really successful opening act, and I really, really enjoyed it. It's excellent. I love it. It's a good game. Love it.
Do you see, gods of Olympus? Do you need more proof than this?
Placing all of his godly power into the weapon had rendered Kratos mortal, vulnerable to the arms of death. Bloodied and beaten, He knew that to have any hope of survival, he must retrieve the Blade of Olympus. Humiliated before his Spartan army, Kratos dragged himself up from the dirt.
Okay, so here we are, bloodied and beaten. Weakened completely. Let's go and get our blade back. Let's get our blade back and regain the powers of the God of War. Everything that was taken from us and put in the Colossus is now in the blade, so we can go and get it now.
Yes, I am forced to attend to this matter myself. Athena refused to undo her mistake. Imagine caring for a creature such as yourself.
Why? Why would you betray me?
It is you who would betray me. Am I to stand idly by while Olympus is threatened? Your hands are already stained by the blood of a god. I will not let Ares' fate be my own.
The gods are petty and pathetic, and your rule is weak.
I grow tired of this insolence. I am the King of Olympus. And it is my way that is the way of the gods. You must vow to forever serve me.
I serve no one.
Then you'll leave me no choice.
I hope you all enjoyed. This is an unwinnable fight against Zeus. I will see you all next time for more Let's Play God of War 2. Bye-bye.
Submit! I would rather die!
It did not have to be this way, my son. This path is of your choosing.
A choice from the gods is as useless as the gods themselves.
Even now, as you draw your last breath, you continue to defy me! Everything you have ever known, Kratos, will now suffer because of your sacrilege. You will never be the ruler of Olympus. The cycle ends here.
You will pay for this, Zeus. Be certain of that.